You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
Hello. Please let me see your ticket stubs for the double-edged double bill. This week, Steven Soderbergh presents the Limey Informant. Each week, Adam Thomas and Thomas Mariani will come to the table to discuss the randomly selected yin and yang of a double feature. Then, both will have to pick a number between 1 and 10 in order to seal their fates for the next episode. One will have two good movies, the other two bad ones. Let the chaos begin. I am Adam Thomas, and tell him I'm coming!
And I'm Thomas Mariani, and Adam, there's just one thing I didn't quite understand there. That's every motherfucking thing you just said.
I love Bill Duke so much.
It's weird. This is the second week in a row where we're covering a revenge movie that features Bill Duke in a small role.
We gotta do Commando next week somehow.
To complete the trilogy. Yes. Complete the entire trilogy. Oh, and over there is a person who I'm sure isn't wearing a wire, or he should be because he's recording a podcast. He should probably have some kind of recording equipment on him. It's Torrey Depina. Torrey, welcome back.
Hey, glad to be back. How you guys doing?
We're fine. Fine. How are you?
As good as, hey, we're into the new year, 7 days in, nothing bad has happened, right?
Nope. It spreads sunshine all over the place, that's what's going on
there
here.
There we go.
Yes, yes, but we are here to talk about, not the depressing state of what's going on right now, but about, two films that we picked at the end of our last episode, given the double-edged double bill of it all. The topic for this week, because this week we're releasing this, is going to be the birthday of Steven Soderbergh. We're talking about Steven Soderbergh movies, which we've talked about at least one directed Soderbergh movie before with Haywire, and we talked about Ocean's 8 previously, which he produced. But Soderbergh is so interesting a filmmaker, which is why I really wanted to cover him on the show, because it's such a prolific career, but also such a very diverse career. Is that why you wanted to come on for this one, Torrey?
He's kind of like, I don't want to say he's like a wild card, but I don't know. I've never known a guy to have this like diverse skill set where it's like 1 minute he's making this like art housey weird crime gangster film like we saw like one of our two choices today, or you know, the Ocean's trilogy, Magic Mike. He has like a signature flair, but it's almost like his signature flair is like hiding his signature flair. It's weird. I don't know how else to describe it.
He's truly the Charlie Day in It's Always Sunny at Filmmakers. He's a wild card.
Yeah, there we go. Yeah.
that's what he does. What about you, Adam? Are you a fan?
Yeah, I guess. No, I like Soderbergh movies. He's not one of my favorites, but that's just because I don't think I'm as well versed in Soderbergh films as I probably should be. I mean, I've seen most of them all, but I've seen them once. I never really like studied them or sort of dissected them before. So, I mean, yeah, I like the guy enough. He's all right. You know, fuck him.
Well, don't get too excited. Calm down. We just got...
Two-thirds of us are on the same page when it comes to that, because that's why I kind of bullshitted my intro there, because I was just like, I've seen like 5 movies.
Oh, well, well.
Wow, you're a filthy liar. At least I was honest.
Hey, just like, hey, I basically just did with the main character of one of our two films that we saw today. So, hey, he's a master of bullshit, and that's what I did.
Right. I'll at least say that I had seen, like, lesser sort of movies before we started this, and per my usual thing with the show, I'm like, I should watch more of like, the movies related to whatever topic we're doing, and I over-research and just, like, go deep into, in this case, Soderbergh's filmography. And what's so interesting is I think, Torrey, despite you know, sitting on a throne of lies with what you just said earlier in your intro, it is pretty accurate about Soderbergh just in terms of, like, he has such a weird sort of proclivity and prolificness for directing movies. He started his career with, obviously, like, Sex, Lies, and Videotape, which kind of helped start the indie boom of the 90s. And then in the 2000s, he kind of started transitioning into more mainstream features. And then by the time we get to, like, his weird kind of I'm gonna retire phase in, like, the early 2010s, he starts realizing, well, I could do TV, and then I could also just go ahead and start shooting movies, but on an iPhone. So the dude, I think, is one of the rare guys who's constantly innovating. Even now, he's, like, pushing 60. Dude is one of the few guys that kind of knows where the film industry is going, I think. Even to a point where I think it was around Unsane, when that wasn't doing that well in theaters, he was like, I know a movie's not doing well by, like, Friday night. I wish there was a button I could just push, and it's like, by Monday it's on Netflix or whatever. Because, like, there's no point in wasting space with, like, a movie that's gonna play for, like, 2 weeks. No one's gonna fucking see it.
Which is true, because, I mean, I'm saying it was, like, film for nothing. So I was under the impression that it actually, like, made money. But obviously, like, when I looked it up, it was, like, obviously not enough. But he seems to me that every film he does, he strives to, like, go with this, like, I don't know, it's like he wants to make a big movie, but he wants to do it as, like, minimalist as possible, if that makes any fucking sense. It's weird, which is, like, you know, I can commend that just off, like, the theme alone, I guess, or whatever. Because, I mean, like I said, Unsane's a really good film. I really like that, and shooting it on an iPhone, like, like, this is a Hollywood production. I'm going to shoot it on an iPhone for, like, $2 million and push it in theaters. You know, it's like, that's insane to me.
Right, and you never know what the next step is going to be with him, because it's like you mentioned, the weird thing where it's like, one of our movies is like a small revenge movie, which he followed up with both Aaron Brockovich and Traffic, two major Oscar contenders in like 2000, and then he does like Ocean's 11, this like fun, over-the-top kind of like heist movie, and then Solaris? Mm. Like, it's this weird just like, I don't know, I'm just going where the wind takes me. And I can respect that, even if, like, I would say also, despite, like, that kind of, like, weird structure of it, of his career, I would say he has more hits than misses, from what I've seen. There's only a few that I would say would be bad to me.
Yeah, like, Ocean's 12. Like, that's kind of, like, my big one as far as, like, his blunders. It's just this really, it was just like, oh, you know, you might have thought Ocean's 11 was pretentious, but you have seen nothing as far as how my pretentiousness will go with this one. I think the only thing I remember that movie being clever about was, you look like Julia Roberts, so we're going to have you pretend to be Julia Roberts.
Oh, that's literally like, the worst scene in the whole movie. The worst exactly. Sequence in the whole thing.
It's entertaining, though, even though it's so bad.
Vincent Cassell breakdancing through laser lights was entertaining.
That too.
It's pretty dope. But we're not talking about any of those specific movies this week. We're talking about two movies that, as I mentioned, we picked at the end of our last show, randomly, and we ended up getting, for our good pick, my choice of The Limey, his 1999 film. And then 10 years later, we get our bad choice that Adam picked, which was The Informant. So we'll be going in chronological order. And let's go ahead and start off then with The Limey.
My name's Wilson. You wrote me about my daughter. This bloke she was bunked up with.
Terry Valentine.
What's he got to say for himself? You tell him! Get to get what I'm after. You tell him I'm coming! The day I die. Tell him I'm coming!
So, The Limey came out, as I mentioned, in 1999, on October 8th, 1999, as directed by Steven Soderbergh and written by Lem Dobbs, who he's collaborated with a couple times, and stars Terence Stamp, and this is one, unfortunately, I don't think a lot of people would really remember, because it wasn't very successful at the time it came out in 1999, very crowded year, obviously. I would say, and I believe from what was indicated at the end of our last episode, Adam would agree, this is a very underrated gem.
Oh, yeah, dude, definitely. Back in the day, like, the videos that would come out, you know, whether they were released by, like, Artisan or something like that, they'd always run the same trailers before the movies, like, for every movie you rented or bought, and this was one of those trailers that was on every single fucking movie. So that's how I heard about it. I'm like, well, this looks pretty cool. That fucking General Zod going Cockney, I'm down for that. And, yeah, I really, really dug it. And it features a I Can Stand Peter Fonda as well, so... only in this role, but still, yeah, I think this is absolutely just a underseen, underrated gem of a film.
Well, Torrey, I'm curious, had you heard or seen this one before we gave it to you for the show?
No, absolutely not. I just heard about it this week, honestly, when you had told me about what the episode was going to be. I really liked it. Couldn't believe it was like only like 90 minutes, like hour and a half, but it had so much in it. For some reason, I got the same vibe out of this movie that I got watching the Nicolas Cage Bad Lieutenant film, where it's just like the story is obviously not this like world beating story of something that you've never seen before, but the way it's shot is something that it really hasn't been shot like before. So I really like the style. Acting is concerned. For some reason, Terence Stamp kind of threw me off a couple of times when he was delivering lines. I kind of got the I'm coming line kind of. I didn't know if that was trying to be comical or not, or if he was just chewing the scenery for that one moment. But as far as like the acting performances, they're really consistent. Like, this isn't just like some shoot 'em up, you know, like it slowly builds up to these scenes of like when like the chase scene that happens between I forgot the actor's name, the one who's basically like Peter Fonda's henchman, like head henchman. I forgot the actor's name right now off the top of my head. But like that chase scene is not really like over the top crazy. It kind of feels like what a real chase scene would be. It was an ordinary crime story, but it wasn't shot in an ordinary fashion. And that's what grabbed my eye watching it. And I just thought to myself the entire time, like, I can't believe I never heard of this. This is the kind of crime film that's up my alley. It's unique in how it's shot. I would say even unique in how it's acted. And it's like it's just a straight slow burn, you know, and I really appreciate it for that.
Yeah, I think the closest thing I would probably compare it to in terms of another movie is one we've covered for the show and we both also love is Ghost Dog, Way of the Samurai. It has a lot of the same kind of like underplayed kind of version of a like noir movie.
I'd say it's accurate with a lot of like the voiceover and the repeating voiceover lines several times and things like that. Or I'd say it's very, very close in, if not tone, even design of Ghost Dog.
Yeah. And by the way, you were referring to Barry Newman.
Okay. Yeah,
the right-hand man of Peter Fonda, which I think it's also, to add to what you're talking about, I love the cast of this movie. It's such a like bunch of great like character actory people you would recognize, like Terence Stamp, of course, being the lead. But even like Luis Guzman, who's always fun to see in a character actor kind of persona, or Lizzie Ann Warren, or Peter Fonda even. I think it has like this great mix of like interesting faces that feels like it would be natural to like going to LA in the late 90s and finding either like burnouts or people who are just trying to chill, live their, you know, lives in the middle of all this. And I think it really stands to, especially Terence Stamp, who before this, as Adam mentioned, you would know as like General Zod in the Superman movies, amongst other things, you would see his face, or of course in the Star Wars in Phantom Menace, when he just shows up to give like exposition and shit. And so like he's been like a character actor for a while, but I love him in this movie because this movie kind of feels like it's the best version of a Death Wish movie to me, which is to say, the revenge doesn't actually result in much of anything. And this guy is still ultimately alone and sad by the end of it. And I think that's the perfect way for it to go.
Don't talk shit about Death Wish. Watch it. Think about if it was Charles Bronson trying to deliver these lines. Tell him I'm coming. He's got a wish.
Especially if he tries a Cockney accent.
Yeah. Hey, you better tell him I'm coming.
Right, for sure. No, I agreed with Torrey too, actually. The first time I saw this, I was a little bit sort of thrown by Terence Stamp the very first time I saw this movie because he is sort of chewing up the scenery a lot, especially the I'm coming scene and stuff like that. But other than that scene, most of his stuff is very dry and wooden. On purpose. That's the point of the character. And the first time, I don't think I recognized that. But other than that, he doesn't do a whole crazy lot of emoting. Especially with his face and stuff like that. He's really sort of cold and calculating and sort of to the point the whole time. And I think he works really well in this. And he's so intimidating, especially being an older guy with this like white, barely there hair and these crystal blue eyes. But you believe instantly like, oh, no, he's the toughest guy maybe in the room right now, if not the whole city of Los Angeles. Like he's incredibly intimidating and scary.
Even when he does his little walk, which I love when he's right before the I'm coming bit, when he's just like, like his fucking shoulders are going back and forth and shit.
Yep. I like that part. But I really got to say, man, I really like Peter Fonda in this movie, man, as this sort of burned out, you know, still loves the 60s and idolizes specifically 2 years of the 60s still. And he's sort of in over his head with all these criminal dealing stuff. And he's just all about, you know, hey, man, I just want to sort of get by. Like, and he's really good in it. Like, you totally believe, A, why these younger women would be into him, not only because of the money, but sort of the way he is and the way his attitude is and the way he approaches things. But you also, it totally makes sense. Like, she was going to call the fucking cops. What was he going to do? Like, he's just a total pansy, too. And it totally works for me in this movie with him. But I really don't fucking like him. And he's really good in this. I can get behind him in this.
I think it's because it feels like it's the least amount of acting needed for
it's
Peter Fonda.
Yeah, it's just, yeah. It's just big him. Yeah, that's true, man. Oh, yeah, I always hit this deer. Have I told you this story? No, yeah, but you can tell it again. You're so nice. Like, oh, this fucking gross leather skinned.
Okay. Shit. Especially the intro to his character being the bit where he's talking to his younger lover, and he just mentions right off the bat, like, you know, when your parents were asking about a name, I'm like, oh.
I know.
Sick son of a bitch. Oh, this is so creepy.
He's banging his friend's, like, 20-year-old daughter that he recommended the name for. What? It's so nasty.
But how do you feel about Stamp and Fonda, Tori?
I think Adam kind of just took the words out of my mouth. I mean, I mentioned earlier, like, the scenes where he needed to be intense. Surprised that Peter Fonda, that they would have, like, such a pathetic, like, villain. It kind of made me wonder this entire time, like, how the fuck did this guy rise to power in the first place? He's so fucking, like, he's just gross. He's just pathetic. You know, it seems to me, if anybody, it's Barry Newman's character. I think his character's name's Jim. Like, Jim seemed like, I would have thought for a second he was, like, when they first focused to him after the I'm coming scene, I'm thinking, oh, this must be the guy that Terrence Stamp's going to go after. Clearly, look at him. He's evil. But then it just paints to this guy who's, like, having a panic attack mid-conversation. Like, this being linked to me. I don't want to bother with it. I have a 20-year-old that I suggested my best friend to name that I'm going to have a sexual relationship with. And I'm like, this is the fucking villain? And but it plays well to, like, the film's strength of, you know, like you said before, like, the theme of revenge not really being something satisfying, because, you know, like, when it gets to that point in the climax, it's like, wow, you just, you know, you thought he was pathetic, but man, he's really fucking pathetic as far as a villain is concerned. But he plays it well, you know, as far as, like, Stamp goes. I mean, like you said, he's cold, he's calculating. And the thing about that throws me off about it necessarily being sad, I didn't get the whole thing of sadness. I kind of, like, got a whole thing of, like, yeah, he gets what's going on, but, like, so many things or so many, like, situations he's in throughout the entire movie, he literally just shrugs it off and goes, oh, okay. And then just, you know, kind of moves on and just keeps it inside and keeps it to himself. And that, to me, is, like, kind of, like, the real tragedy of, like, you know, his character. It's not necessarily that he's just, like, you know, this dude who's just, like, even after he gets his revenge, supposedly, you know, I guess, like, closest that you can get to his revenge. You know, the way he kind of just, like, goes about it, it kind of feels like how he goes about a lot of things throughout the movie, you know, like he doesn't really, like, wear it out, you know, he like, I think the thing with his character is that he keeps inside everything he does, you know, and it's just like, oh, all right, I guess it's on to my next job or on to the next step that I need to do in my life, you know.
Well, right, but I think that's the thing, is that there's a real sadness that I think comes from, one, it's a Stamp sort of, like, performance of, like, especially whenever he's talking about his daughter and how much of, like, oh, I remember the fun game that we had where she was a little girl and she kept saying she'd call the cops if I try to pull another job. Like, that's the happy memory. The sadness is really coming from just the fact that he's looking back on his life and he's, like, this determined cold killer, but he doesn't have, like, anything else. Like, there's even that great bit I love where Luis Guzman is just, like, driving him and the casual conversation is like, hey, man, you have any friends? Like, that's the big sort of, like, connecting moment is him talking about just, like, hey, do you have any, like, connection? I think a lot of that comes from the weird editing style, which was not intended originally. Soderbergh originally wanted to play this out like a straight, you know, movie, like, chronologically and linearly. And he played it that way, like, when he presented the original cut. And he agreed, everyone else agreed, like, oh, this is a terrible cut. It's not going to work. So he, like, worked for months with the editor to, like, really restructure the whole movie, and it becomes more of, like, this weird memory-based editing that I think really works for it, because I think it's kind of doing the sadness that I'm talking about. It's a lot of him reflecting, like, you see shots of him, like, on the air, plane flight back, or even like moments after a scene that we see play out in full just right after a shot like that. It shows so much of like it's him looking back at these moments and kind of just realizing like, oh, I found like some kind of like friend connection with like a Luis Guzmán, Leslie Ann Warren, but that's completely lost to me now because I'm so hell-bent on this mission. And when he ultimately culminates in that mission, he just realizes like, oh wait, that's not going to really solve anything. And whatever, like, solace he gets, it's just like, I'm not going to kill this one guy I went after this whole time. And that's his solace. And I think that works so well for his character. That's, like, that's his idea of progression and growth. It's like, I'm not going to kill this one guy, even though I killed a lot of people along the way to get here.
I don't know. It's like, I kind of got that. I got that, honestly, like, from how you're describing it. Like, yeah, I did get that vibe, but I also got that vibe that he's probably just going to go back to the UK and still continue on as being this cold-blooded killer because, you know, what else does he have?
Right, that's the sadness. That's what I'm talking about. That's his sadness.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, exactly. You know what I mean? But, like, I don't know. Maybe because, like, the editing was always, like, the way the film's edited. I don't want to say that it kind of, like, robs the emotional weight of his character, but it kind of, maybe it's just my stupid, dumb ADD brain that's, like, not processing it right. But I'm like, it kind of distracts me a little bit in a good way. Like, I'm not saying that it's, like, it's a bad thing, but it does kind of distract, it does kind of, I think, pull away a little bit from the emotional weight of his character, just at least in my opinion.
How do you feel about the editing, Adam?
I get where Torrey's coming from. Again, now we're going back to when I very first saw this. I thought it was a little jarring and things like that. I think it's pretty good, man. I think it's cool. I think it's a unique way of telling this story about this sort of sad, lonely old man who's gotten knows nothing but crime. And I think it works perfectly. And I really do love the cuts of the old Terence Stamp movie. And they work seamlessly. You totally believe that that's the same character from this movie. The sort of remembering cuts and flashbacks and the voiceover work, it's sort of, it feels like maybe even the character, Wilson, sort of last-ditch effort to maybe even hold on to these memories or to try to preserve them in a different way than they actually are. Like you said, his happiest memory is his daughter constantly crying about him being a criminal and threatening to call the cops, and he just thinks it's so fucking sweet and cute. It's really sad and kind of pathetic. And, yeah, to me, I really do enjoy the editing of this. It doesn't bother me now, but, yeah, when I first saw it, it was definitely a little jarring. I will agree with that.
Yeah, but I think it does really work to kind of like immerse you sort of in his mindset to where it's like, I agree. I don't think he realizes this entire thing is kind of sad. There's a sadness to him about, no, like, my daughter died. But also he doesn't quite realize it, like, oh, he's living this life that's so like completely kind of empty and meaningless. Even talking about like, oh yeah, I once had some friends and then some of them died and some of them I found out they weren't really friends.
Right. Yeah, no, I agree with you. The thing is too, it's not even him being sad because his daughter's dead. He doesn't really mourn her, really, the whole time. The whole point of the movie is just to find out what happened to her and get the people that did. There's no real mourning scene in this movie. You never see him break down and cry or get sad, like, ever, except when he's telling that story. But other than that, yeah, you never get the even sense idea. And he kind of even alludes to it, like, you know, I was never really a dad to her. She didn't really know me and blah, 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 blah. It's a revenge tale at its pure and simple base. Someone wronged him in a way because they hurt somebody that he's directly sort of related to. So therefore he has to take them out and take care of it because it's in some way intrinsically tied to him. I never once really got the feeling that there was a real sense of father-daughter love in the movie at all. Like I said, it's more or less what these people did to him, not even necessarily to her.
It's a very stripped down kind of revenge thriller in a way that allows for a lot more room to like kind of explore the characters in a way that really works. I think it's really essential to Soderbergh. I think that's what really sort of he brings to this kind of a story, especially with, you know, stuff like even Peter Fonda, like the few character moments we get of him are like, oh yeah, this, our evil big bad is just this like kind of slimy former music producer piece of shit who lives on a fucking beach. And I think that stripped down is also works even for like some of the action beats we do get, like the Tell Him I'm Coming scene, which is like, I think this really quiet, but like really like intense kind of moment of actual like violent outburst, or even later on when he's at Peter Fonda's party that he's having, and there's like the shots we get of like Peter Fonda getting shot and the fantasy shots of that, and then also later on the bit where he fucking throws that dude over the railing, and it's just so matter of fact. I think that's what makes it kind of like darkly comic but also very intimidating from like a Stamp, is that he just does this so quickly and doesn't even think about it.
I would say that's I agree with that. I mean, I guess the what I should say is when it comes to his character is that, you know, you never really get that sense that he's mourning, but maybe, you know, in a way, I think the moments that you do see where he's like having these imaginations of murdering Peter Fonda, those are like the closest that we will get to like any sort of like, I want to say beyond the, besides the story, like an emotional response to, you know, somebody who had wronged him. I think Soderbergh does a good job at immersing you into like the landscape and the surroundings and the, like, you know, the cinematography, like he immerses you into this world, but I don't think like maybe it's not supposed to immerse me really into this character. You're just sort of just watching this shit sort of culminate into, you know, how it ends or whatever. And it's just like, and that's not, it sounds like it's a complaint, but it really isn't. Like, that's the thing. Like I view like Stamp's character as being pretty amoral, no different than I would the movie A Prophet, which is like a French crime film. You know, it's kind of like an amoral following of this character. You know, he's not inherently good, you know, but I mean, you're still kind of following his story anyway. And everything else just comes together in a way where it's like you're still getting something that's entertaining, you're still getting a great story being told to you, but you're not really getting a good glimpse really of like the character himself, like, because like Adam said, you're not really getting that period of mourning with Terence Stamp. It's just, I'm here, I'm gonna get revenge, these people wronged me, and that's it. And to me, that's, you know, that's not a bad thing, you know what I mean? But so I could see somebody who would probably want a little bit more seeing that as like a detriment. You know, that's just, at least for me watching it from the time I watched it, you know.
I don't disagree with what you're saying in a way, but the thing is, you got to figure most major sort of crime heist, whatever you want to call them, mafia movies, not most, if not, God, what, at least 75% of them, the main character is not redeemable. You follow a piece of shit. I mean, you can go down the list. You can go Goodfellas, Casino, Heat. I mean, there's just constant these characters who, if not, are completely morally bankrupt. They live right in the gray. This one, it is different. It's of a different ilk. I mean, it's the same sort of idea as that, but it is definitely of a different ilk because it's not super flashy, and it's not look how much shit he's getting from pulling these crimes and the money he's getting and all this stuff. It's a very quietly told, briskly told, little sort of revenge film, which ultimately he doesn't even get his revenge. In a way. I mean, he does in a way, but not in the way that he sort of fantasized about doing the whole time. And it's populated with all these weird art house movie characters. Like Nicky Cat and his buddy.
I wanted to say, I fucking love Nicky Cat so much. He's this piece of
shit.
He's
so good in this.
He is fantastic. He's on screen. I honestly wish I could have got a little more of him. Because he just had like, he just popped like anytime he was on screen. Uh-huh. His performance. It was just...
they really need that. You better hurry up.
Yeah.
Or even just like his power trip is getting his buddy to like break at a fucking dive bar for pool. Like, it's such a sad fucking, like, once again, all these people, it's like Adam kind of mentioned, like this whole like revenge plot is teeming with like the lowest level possible scum criminals in LA. To the point where, like, we don't even see any cops. Like, the cops don't even give a shit. This is how low stakes and pathetic this is of, like, a fucking crime ring, quote-unquote, with, like...
Yeah, you get what? The DEA at one point.
Yeah.
Real quick. And that's it. But even then, though, are those fucking... Are they on the take? Probably. Just because of the way their whole operation's going. You got the feeling they're maybe into some illegal shit, too.
Bill Duke, I think, is my favorite of any of the small people in this movie. Just one fucking scene, and he owns it. Especially with just like, oops, there go my slippery fingers again. He just throws in the fucking folder.
That was amazing. Crazy. That was like a classic one right there.
That whole crazy fucking speech Terence Stamp walks in and just delivers. You're like, this is, that to me is my favorite scene of Terence Stamp in the movie for sure. Cause you're like, he is just so full of shit, just in there. He's just trying to shine this guy on. And this guy is so much more big time than him.
But I love also just, once again, I said that line at the beginning. Bill Duke's reaction is one of my favorite lines, I think, in a movie, honestly. It's just interesting, that goddamn thing you said. Anyway, here's what it actually is going on.
that was kind of a consistent motif I saw throughout the movie too, where it's just like, Luis Guzman walks with, I'm trying to remember the woman's name right now. Was it Lindsay? Yeah, exactly. And she's like, do you understand what the fuck he's saying ever? Like some shit like that. And I kind of feel like
that's like, no, I mean, I think I know what he means. But
and if it was done in like a fucking Guy Ritchie film, it would just be like a fucking beat to death gag. But in this, it's like it just comes in like it's consistent, but it's never like beat over your head. You know what I mean? It comes in just these subtle points in conversation where it's just like it doesn't annoy you with it. It doesn't like you just browbeat you over the fucking head with it, like if you were to watch like Rock and Roller or like a bad Guy Ritchie film.
Well, that's what it feels like. It feels like a Rock and Roller like super side character walked into this LA like very chill kind of crime movie that's going on. It's just like everyone rightly is just saying, who's this fucker here? I don't know what he's like. Everyone's just confused by him, like especially the scene where he breaks into like the truck, you know, moving complex, like right before the I'm telling you I'm coming. All these guys are like the most like nonchalant, like guys who move trucks and shit. Like even the guy looks like he's the second stuntman for like Tom Wilson, the guy who plays Biff in the Back to the Future movies. Like he's so nondescript a fucking person. It's just like, who even are you? How did you get into my office?
Dude, that's Piney for fucking Sons of Anarchy. Like his name's William Lucking. He played the guy with that had the breathing apparatus the whole time in Sons of Anarchy. I was just like, dude, Terrence Stamp just kicked Piney in the nuts. This is awesome. He's just playing like a run of the mill like henchman at an illegal operation that you've seen in like so many crime films. But mm-hmm. One of my favorite shots, honestly, is just like after Stamp gets the shit beat out of him. And he's just like, he just walks back in. He stands up, dusts himself off. You see the gun in the back of his pants because you remember he got two of them. And he's just walking right in. And you're like, oh, no, we're not going to get to see any of it. We're just going to hear that shit. We just know something just went the fuck down. And it's just like a perfectly shot scene. It's like, man, I don't want to say Tarantino. Ask because then I'm gonna sound like a dickhead, but
well, but it's not as overly stylized as like a Tarantino movie. That's what I really like.
It's like
about
subtle.
It.
It's like constrained. You know, it's like restrained Tarantino.
Yeah, you hear a couple shots when he goes inside, and that one guy runs out, and he does the "you tell him I'm coming" thing. That's the thing. Like it's this line that like in someone else's hands could be like, oh, it's this big culminating moment for this movie. It kind of feels like it could be that, but especially when you rewatching it here, and even when I rewatched it earlier, like last year in the middle of quarantining, I was like, oh shit, like this is like really just a sad moment. Like this is a triumph for him, but it's a really small, pathetic. I'm like, you killed a bunch of guys like in a fucking truck warehouse. I'm like, no one's gonna give a shit.
Yeah, and they immediately take the piss out of it too with the following conversation. Tell them I'm coming. What the fuck does that mean? Coming for who? they're like, what? Who the fuck is this guy? Again, it's like all these things have such meaning to him. These people don't fucking care about this guy or give him really no mind up until the last two thirds of the movie. Once he throws homeboy off the balcony, then they're like, oh, this guy's serious. They don't give a fuck about this guy.
Well, and I like also even the undoing of our villains is actually at the hands of like some other shitty low level like hood that they tried to hire up. Like that's what I love is that Terrence Stamp doesn't like kill anybody during the climax. It's all just, like, a bunch of infighting horse shit for this, like, really lower-level, meager-ass, like, criminal organization that's going on here.
I mean, it pretty much is the ending of Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels. Like, literally, that happens at this house. It's just, like, somehow, some way, these mediocre henchmen just end up leading to a shoot. It's basically like, wait, you're getting killed by your own guy. Your own operation is falling apart. I mean, imagine dying in this scenario and thinking to yourself, damn, I really shouldn't have fucking hired these, like, dipshits. I should have just let them play pool and just left them fucking be. Because, like...
And the last thing you did was watch fucking Access Hollywood with fucking Peter Fonda while you, like, were putting the shells inside the fucking bowl.
For $5,000. That's it. That's what he hired these two guys to kill him for. $5,000. And that's literally it. I mean, it's fucking, like you said, they're just low-level scumbags. Like, it's really slimy and sleazy and sort of, like, not even the good, like, dirty underbelly of fucking, like, crime like you see in movies. These are just fucking posers, basically. It's just a bunch of fucking jokers who think they're big shots.
Yeah, I think that's what really works about it. But let's go ahead. We have a whole other movie to talk about. So let's go ahead and wrap up on the Limey. Go ahead, Torrey, your final thoughts on the Limey.
I know I sounded like I was kind of like back and forth as far as how I was like, you know, my thoughts in the film. But I really do think this is a great film as far as Steven Soderbergh's filmography. I was surprised. Well, I guess I shouldn't say surprised, but I was just taken aback by seeing a film like a restrained type of revenge film from him. considering that the films I've seen later on haven't, you know, they would have like moments of subtlety and then, you know, moments of just, you know, it's not subtle whatso fucking ever. I would say when it comes to this movie, you know, I'm probably going to give it another viewing again, just because like this film's still so fresh in my mind. And I, like I said, I didn't expect this when I initially saw it. And I do think, like I said before, I really like the cast. I really like how it's shot. I really like how different it goes about a revenge thriller, even though I feel like it does definitely take some of its, you know, motifs and shit from like other crime films. But it's just, it's shot in a way where it feels way more original than the films that it's borrowing things from. This is a solid film, and I'm grateful for seeing it.
Well, and Adam, your final thoughts on The Limey?
I've always liked this movie. I will always like this movie. I don't watch it very often. In fact, I think this might be the first time I've seen it in a couple of years, if not, you know, even longer. But every time I see it, I really like it. I love the aesthetic of it. I really dig the acting in it. I like that it's just this little personal sort of crime thriller. Does some really like sort of arts house independent tricks to it with the way it's shot and edited and some of the narrative. But yeah, I think it's a really fun little movie that, you know, I get why, though, it's not as well known or as sort of celebrated as some of his other movies or even movies like this, because it is definitely different, of a different cloth than pretty much anything he's done and other movies like this. But I think it's really, really cool. And it's just kind of, I hate to use this word, but it's just like a hip ass movie. Like, it's fucking cool. It's one of those movies that, like, around the time it came out in 99, you had sort of this explosion of these type of movies like this, Ghost Dog, you know, Boondock Saints, things like that, where it's these cool little movies that didn't get a lot of theatrical play and not a lot of media coverage, but they're there and they're cool and they exist in this sort of time capsule, because you don't get movies like this anymore. And for that, I mean, I'll always love it. I think it's really fun.
I would say that we do kind of get movies like this more recently as of yet, but I think that's the thing, is that like this kind of like smaller crime movie was kind of killed after, like, at the dawn of the new millennium. But I think as we've gotten, especially like A24 or Annapurna movies, we've gotten a lot more movies like this that are like smaller scale, that kind of like go into like more of the character stuff of these genre tropes of like the criminal. And I think that's the thing, is this feels like it's very predictive almost of like an A24. I think that's why Soderbergh feels so kind of ahead of the curve in his own way, because it's like telling this familiar story in an intimate kind of perspective, and I love the way that it does it. This is my favorite of Soderbergh's movies, I would say. I love stamping it. I love the whole cast. I think it does so much of, like, the reason I was maybe clowning on Death Wish early, I think I've said this even on the show before, it's just like those kind of revenge thrillers aren't as interesting to me because they give you the idea of like, oh yeah, this revenge is gonna make it all worth it. But kind of like what we talked about with Mandy last week, I love the idea of these revenge thrillers where it's like they do their thing. They kind of get to their certain point of like, oh, this is going to be so satisfying and worth it. And either, you know, in the case of Mandy, he does it and then nothing kind of culminates from it. Or in this case, he almost gets there and he realizes, oh, this isn't going to change anything. I'm still just going to be me. And he might go off and keep on being like a piece of shit thug. But at the same time, he has this moment of clarity where he realizes, like, this isn't going to bring my daughter back. This isn't going to do anything. And I love a movie that comes at a kind of point like that. So yeah, if you have not seen this, I would definitely recommend it. As Torrey mentioned, it's on like Tubi TV. It usually plays on like the cheapest streaming services possible, because it's not an expensive movie to get the rights to, I'm sure. But yeah, would definitely recommend this one. And before we get to our next feature, here is an ad for an ESO you can queue up right after ours.
The 42 cast is turning 100, but like all good things, it must come to an end. Tune in to our epic finale as we see who lives, who dies, and who gets their own spinoff. And then come back when the 42 cast is back for season 2, with even more segments, more guests, and more of explaining why Ryan is wrong. It's why we're still the ultimate answer to fandom, geekiness, and everything. You can only find all this awesome by downloading the 42 cast, a proud member of the ESO Network.
All right, and now we're going into our bad feature, The Informant. I gotta say that because it's got an exclamation point. The Informant.
What I'm about to tell you, it involves something very large.
Everyone in this country is a victim of corporate crime by the time they finish breakfast.
Yes.
Things are going on I don't approve of. I mean, I feel real bad about that.
Would you be willing to wear a wire? We need your help.
7:30 a.m. I am approaching the entrance to the office.
You don't really need to narrate the tapes for us when you're
absolutely
making them.
Just not a problem.
I want you to keep this secret.
Absolutely. Don't tell us anything.
It's very important to your case you not discuss this with anyone else.
I'm a person of interest in an ongoing investigation.
Oh my God.
So The Informant came out September 18th, 2009, was directed by Steven Soderbergh based on a script from Scott Z. Burns. And this is a true story in which Matt Damon plays a guy named Mark Whitaker, who was actually part of this company that in the early 90s that produced something called lysine. That's basically like a corn product that kind of keeps your, you know, sort of starch preserved, basically, for stuff like cereal and orange juice, anything. Anything that you eat during your breakfast is kind of, like, formed around this lysine stuff. And there was some price fixing around that, doesn't it sound boring as I'm talking about this? And that's the thing of the movie. It's kind of, it's this kind of interesting take on a boring story, I would say. But I think all people really remember this for is this is the movie where Matt Damon gained like 30 pounds. And he looked kind of fat.
Yep, and he had a mustache. And the poster's really silly. I agree. You know, The Informant is... you know, the thing is, I saw it right when it came out because of the Matt Damon thing. And I didn't remember shit really about it until rewatching it for the show. And I know why I didn't remember anything about it till watching it for the show. To me, it is just a meandering bore of a film. Matt Damon in dialogue spouting out, like the first couple times spouts off these kooky facts. You're like, oh, this is kind of cool. By the time he gets to like fucking fact number 20 about polar bears or something, you're like, all right, who cares? It's just, to me, it's so easily telegraphed to like what's going on, even if you don't know the true story. Nah. Great cast and a lot of like comedic act.
The most stacked like comedy cast of all time for this not that very funny movie.
Yeah, it's a pretty serious cast. I mean, there's a lot of good actors in it.
It's a serious cast of funny people.
Yeah, and they're all pretty good in it. Everyone's pretty good in it. It's shot good. It looks good. The acting's good. It's just boring. It's super boring, and it feels like it lasts for fucking ever.
Well, Torrey, what do you think of The Informant? Oh, I'm sorry, The Informant! What do you think of it?
You guys have done a decent amount of episodes with me, and I've done this before, so I'm really fucking sorry when I say this. I really love this movie.
No, there's no problem. Like, look, someone has some excitement about The Informant. Go ahead, express it.
I think Matt Damon's performance is so good, and I think honestly the surrounding cast is so good that I honestly wasn't bored throughout the entirety of watching this. And I think maybe it's because it's more to do with like the tone. It's pretty satirical. I just really like, I don't know, there's something about it that I kind of thought was a lot more of an easier viewing of this than I did with the Limey, honestly, in comparison to the Limey. It's kind of like a more whimsical version of, The Big Short in a way. Because, you know, you were just watching, like, you know, you have no choice. You're just watching, like, this financial collapse surrounding around you. You're just watching a specific, like, not just financial, but, like, mental collapse of somebody who had, like, all the ambition in the world. But he's an idiot. A pathological liar and an idiot. And you're just, like, it's kind of like the thing where it's, like, you have a character that's so detestable. But for some reason, maybe because of the character's charm, maybe because of Matt Damon's performance. You kind of have this thing inside where it's, like, will he actually pull this off? Even though you know the true story, he doesn't pull it off. You kind of see it, like, all this nonsense you're seeing, all these, like, very stupid things that you're seeing him do where he's, like, simultaneously, like, he's trying to, like, dip his toes halfway into the water of, like, trying to be a whistleblower and thinking at the same time that I can take over this guy. Like, the thought process alone is just, like, what drew me into this film. Like, no matter how, especially towards, like, the third act where everything is just falling the fuck apart. And it just comes from being, like, pathetic to just downright sad. And just, like, all the character interactions that happen, like, throughout the film, it just, I don't know. It wasn't boring to me. Even for like something that I saw that I didn't even think I'd ever see on screen. I'm like, I'm seeing Richard Horvitz in a fucking live action role. When does this happen?
Voice of Invader Zim. Yes.
Yeah. Voice of Invader Zim, Billy, you know, just random stuff like that. And it's just like, it's a great collection of comedic character actors. And then of course, just being anchored by Matt Damon's performance himself. And it's like, maybe it's because maybe this is like quote unquote an actor's movie or whatever. Cause I mean, I couldn't tell you if like, you know, the plot was really that great. It was just a run of a mill plot of like, you know, oh, someone's rise and fall, but they didn't really rise. They kind of just took like maybe two steps up and then had these like, and they just had this like ambitious, like, wave hit upon them, and then it's just like, oh yeah, here's reality, and then it just falls the fuck apart, as it should.
So. I think that really works for at least the first 30 minutes or so of it, and I think it's really on the strength of, I agree, I think the biggest asset to this movie, it's not just that Matt Damon like gained the 30 pounds, he does pull like a really interesting comedic performance in terms of, it's what you're talking about, this guy pulled off this massive kind of like embezzlement, price fixing related like scheme against both his company and the U.S. government. And he seems to do it like more of just like a force of habit of being a compulsive liar. And he looks like a fucking fat version of Ned Flanders, which is like, he's so unassuming that you wouldn't think he would be like capable of doing all this shit. But I think that's what's kind of interesting, at least from, I think, his performance standpoint. And I think it especially works whenever like the two sort of his biggest scene partners in the movie, who I think are really great together, are Joel McHale and Scott Bakula as the FBI agents, I think really work well off of him for what we're kind of talking about, where it's like reacting off of Mark Whitaker being this weird person that you can't believe is really doing any of this. And I think they get the most interesting kind of like comedic material out of like being the straight man for that scenario. But this huge cast that we're talking about, like we mentioned, like Richard Stephen Horvitz or like Clancy Brown's also there, Patton Oswalt, Rick Overton, Tom Papa, Tom Wilson from Back to the Future, Paul F. Tompkins, like they're all like really funny character actors when they can be in other things. And here I just think they're kind of doing the exact same thing that like, say, McHale and Bakula are doing, but with just like less material, because it's just like, oh my god, Matt Damon is like this unassuming guy who, it turns out, is like a compulsive liar who says stupid shit. And I think that joke gets really old after the first, like, 30 minutes or so of the movie.
Yeah, that's basically what I was trying to say, though. It's the joke wears so thin for me so fast. I never once felt sympathy for the Damon character in this at all. He's a horrible con man, a horrible pathological liar. He's using and abusing everyone around him, including members of his own family, his parents, whatever you want to call it. Maybe it's because of the time we're living in now. But watching a movie about a rich sort of erudite CEO sort of on the up and up of this major corporation who's also a pathological liar and a piece of shit, didn't really connect for me right now.
What are you talking about? This movie where John Dowd, the fucking lawyer for Trump during like the 2016 like election shit, being in this movie? How did that not appeal to you right now? It's so great.
I don't know. That's why I said, I mean, maybe it's just me. Maybe it's you guys. You know what, you guys aren't learned enough. I think that's the problem. But no, it didn't appeal to me when it came out either, though, because it's like, I don't mind movies about white collar crime and embezzlement and sort of these corporations and, you know, the seedy shit that goes on in them and everything. I really don't. In fact, I tend to enjoy some of them. But this one tried to make it almost too sort of funny. Like, you're says, this is funny. This guy defrauded millions of people and the government. I mean, he's just a piece of shit. And I don't find any sort of joy or fun out of it. You know, like another one I would even equate to is like even like Wolf of Wall Street or Wall Street, the original. Like, don't get me wrong, I like Wolf of Wall Street. I like the performances in it and everything like that. But still, at the same time, fuck this guy. Like, he's a piece of shit. Like, it doesn't do it for me. And this is kind of the same way I feel about this. It's, yeah, I really do like Scott Bakula in it. I'm a Bakula-holic. I think that's a thing. If not, I'm trademark TM. I like Joel McHale in it. I like, you know, Tom Papa, Paul F. Tompkins when they show up and stuff. It's really cool. But there's just such a major disconnect for me because, again, fuck these guys.
With those movies you talk about, like A Wolf of Wall Street, or even the one I would kind of compare it to is a movie we talked about on the show with I Love You, Philip Morris. Like, these movies are about people that con others out of money, but the difference is I think those other movies escalated in a more interesting way, where, like, it gets to absurd lengths and they go, like, much more over the top, as opposed to Soderbergh's trying to make this a lot more, like, kind of grounded and realistic a movie, obviously, because it's, like, based on this true story that he kind of wants to give me, like, oh, this can happen even, like, an average, like, really shitty cubicle setup for, like, a fucking place that makes corn and shit like that in this case. And I just think, like, it kind of gets boring because the joke is so much more repetitive. I think the most interesting sort of, like, comedic beats to the movie for me are, like, one, Tony Hale, who we haven't mentioned, who I think is fun as his lawyer. Like, there's a bit where they talk about, like, you know what, I want to sue them because they hit me with a briefcase, and Tony Hale's reactions are really funny, and I'm a lot more animated. Or even, I really love when they call up his parents, and they find out, like, oh, he's been lying about them being hit with the car and all that. And they have his dad, who, by the way, is Frank Welker, the guy who does, like, all the animal voices in, like, live-action movies. And he's also, like, he's the voice of Scooby-Doo, and he's been the voice of Fred since the beginning. He's been in so many things. It's his first live-action role in, like, ages. And his wife asks him, like, so how do you feel about, like, Mark saying that we died and he got adopted? And he, like, pushes his glasses up, like, well, that's a bit weird. Like, that's fun. But I just think most of the time it's just a lot of people in boardrooms kind of talking to Matt Damon about, like, hey, how come you did the price-fixing thing and embezzled? Well, I didn't tell you about this either. And I think it got kind of repetitive for me more than anything. But you didn't feel that as much, Torrey?
I didn't feel it as much, and I also kind of had this, like, this kind of gave me the emotional satisfaction that, let's say, I didn't really get from the Limey, because I got to have the emotional satisfaction of seeing this man fall apart and crumble due to his just incredibly weak fucking foundation of lies, the throne of lies, if you will, and seeing him suffer as a result. All while having the, you know, the entertainment factor of, will he actually fucking get away with any of this? Like, because I didn't really look into, like, the, you know, I didn't spoil anything for me. I didn't really look into the story. I just wanted to take it for what it is. Like, it's just kind of like a, you get the satisfaction of either, you know, being shocked, oh, he actually gets away with this, or you get the emotional satisfaction of just seeing him just completely fall on his face to the point where it's so goddamn pathetic. And to mirror it to real life circumstances, you kind of just wish this would happen right now. So this was like fantasy for me in a way, which is ironic considering that this film is, like you said, very grounded. And, you know, the thing, I didn't want to say it because I thought it sounded kind of dumb in my head. I did get I Love You Philip Morris vibes from this, but obviously just not as wacky, not as zany, because, like I said, the zaniness is kind of, you kind of get it in sparks, you know, you don't really get like a full like exposure to it, you know, and that's what I kind of like about it. That's what I liked about it. I'm glad they kind of kept the saniness to Matt Damon's character, and they kind of like had all these comedic actors a little more grounded, like, you know, like Patton Oswalt, Paul F. Tompkins, Joe McHale. Like, for some reason, this just clicked with me. You know what I mean? And to see his it's so sweet to see his downfall. Like, maybe it's just like the time I'm watching this now, because like I said, I never saw this before. You know, I kind of pushed it when I saw it, and like nothing really wanted to make me want to see it when I was like 18 when this came out. And I remember seeing all the trailers and the, you know, Us People magazine. Oh, Matt Damon got fatter for this or whatever, because everybody seemed so hyper fixated on that at the time.
But Torrey, he's born. He got fat.
Yeah.
I don't think you understand this. He's like a big muscle guy at the time, but he got like fat.
It's like he looked like me. You know what I mean?
Dude, also, I was watching this. I'm just like, did Jesse Plemons just look at this like, I'm going to steal that look and really own it? And to be fair, he has. He's done a really great job with this.
Yep, and forever.
But, you know, yeah, it's just like, I don't know, like, this film, it took me, it was this just incredibly just pathetic and cringy ride of watching somebody just suffer as a result of, like, just their actions. It's weird. I'm like, wait, am I seeing white collar crime criminals? I'm seeing, wait, rich white people actually suffering consequences for being fucking pieces of shit? This is, like, the best fantasy film I've seen in years.
Well, I mean, what except, like, at the very end, he has, like, a little call, like a card that comes and says, like, no, he still has a pretty high-paying job now. He got out of prison, and he has to...
Yeah, I know, that's what it ruined it, though.
Yeah, oh, I'm sorry to make it. No, you're good. Nobody suffers any consequences. That's the sort of the fucking... the bullshit of it all. I mean, nobody goes through anything. Tom Papp's character, when he gets out, his dad's still filthy rich. He's still going to be filthy rich. Nobody suffers any consequences. Matt Damon does what, 9 years, and still potentially still has $2 point something million hidden away.
Right, as opposed to, I think that's what's more of, like, Wolf of Wall Street makes that a very specific aim. It doesn't do, like, a brief title card. It's like, BT Dubs, this is what Jordan Belfort's doing now. They make that a pretty big factor for the last 5 minutes or so, which is like, hey, by the way, I did all this shit, and I'm off free, and I'm still fucking people like you over. That's what I'm doing here. As opposed to here, it's very plainly just like, oh, yeah, and he... Like, he even said that thing about, like, oh, I have, like, 11 million as opposed to 9. And there's a title card. He's like, and now he has a job still, and he got out of prison. And right. It just feels like, I don't mind that idea, because obviously it's based on a true story, if you're going to, like, culminate with that. But it's so just sort of, like, matter of fact, it's kind of the problem I have with the movie, where I agree, I think it's aiming for kind of making this kind of a, oh, this is a chill, matter-of-fact, white-collar crime movie, and I like the sort of consistency, at least I can give credit to that, with, like, the way it's kind of, like, this yellow almost piss filter that makes it look so bland, and then even the weird Marvin Hamlisch score that sounds like it's an infomercial kind of thing, like a hygiene movie almost, with how jaunty it is. I think that contrast is kind of interesting, but it's a lot of style stuff that just kind of doesn't really work that well for me as much. I think it just gets, like, it has that interesting kind of pop initially, and it's a joke that, as I think Adam mentioned, gets kind of old for me personally after a certain point.
Yeah, what I was saying earlier about, like, you know, as far as, like, him like facing consequences, I mean, like, yeah, to a degree, no, he doesn't. He gets his million. He still has a couple million dollars. He's a CEO at the end. But, like, compared to, like, what his lofty ambitions he had, he still, like, you know, fell on his face. But it's kind of like that thing where I was comparing it earlier to something like The Big Short, where it's, like, ultimately, you know, none of them really face anything for their repercussions, but it's still, like, you still have this, like, anxious, like, this anxiety-ridden ride, and it's just, like, I don't know, maybe it's because I just actually felt, like, emotion from this movie, because I'm, like, 1 minute, it's, like, you know, laughing, I'm angry, then I'm cringing, and then it's just kind of, like, a loop, a feedback loop of that throughout the entirety of the film, and I don't know, maybe it's just me, obviously, but, I don't know, it just kept me glued into the film. As to the point where I really didn't feel like it slowed down on me. I don't know. Something might be wrong with me, guys. I don't know.
No. I know there are other people that like this movie. I mean, there are sort of fans of this film. It's got actually still a pretty high rating as far as on, you know, the interwebs and stuff like that. Like, it's not a universally sort of hated movie. It's not even universally considered, like, one of Soderbergh's worst. It's just where, you know, I'm completely on the flip side of you. It never grabbed me, not once. Like I said, within the first 20 minutes, I'm like, I'm already tired of this. I'm already tired of the narration. I'm already tired of the way it looks as far as the filter and everything. Like, I get it. Like, I get it. And you just, it seems to sort of stay at the same pace for me the whole movie, and like you said, where you notice the cycle that happens and things like that, and I noticed that too, and that's what made it even longer for me, where it's like Thomas even alluded to too, where we're in boardrooms and it's this and this and this, and also I know about this, okay, wait, you lied about that, well, of course I lied, because I had to, because of this and this and this, but there's also this going on, and it just happens over and over.
And don't forget a comedian being kind of voices like, what is that, what you're doing?
Yes, exactly.
But I'll say, at least, like, as we kind of, I guess, edge into closing thoughts here, I'll at least say I prefer it over something like, say, The Laundromat from Soderbergh, which is a lot more of, like, it's him trying to do The Big Short thing, with a lot of the same kind of, like, Adam McKay kind of cuts to, and people talking to the screen and trying to explain things that are going on over and over again. I at least appreciate this more than him trying to do that, because in that movie, that just really falls apart, and there's no, like, real central character to kind of hinge on, as opposed to, like, I would say I'm not a huge fan of this movie, but at least Matt Damon is, like, an interesting presence to lean on, even beyond the weight thing. He just has, like, this dedication to this weird character with even, like, the stream of consciousness narration and the way that he does, like, I think, like, my favorite scene of the movie is probably later on when he is lying about the letterhead to Scott Bakula, and he just, like, they break down everything about, like, the area code wasn't a thing. Oh, well, maybe he had heard about it before, and it's, like, teased in the narration. It just keeps, like, completely breaking down. Like, that scene, I'm just like, I wish the movie had more interesting bits like this, where you got, like, even more into his mindset that isn't just, like, spouting facts, like Adam mentioned. But as it stands, I think it's one of Soderbergh's, like, lesser movies, but I would say it's more like a forgettable camp to me, than necessarily outright bad.
Yeah, I agree.
Any other final thoughts beyond that?
Yeah, I think it's bland. I think it's meandering. I think it's kind of boring. And ultimately, yeah, it's forgettable. I mean, there's good performances in it. They definitely tried to elicit something. And for me, it just failed on every level. Like I said, I've already seen this and I forgot everything about it. And you ask me, fuck, man, 6 months to a year from now, I'll be like, oh, yeah, what was that movie about? I'm not even going to remember.
Matt Damon's fat in it, right?
Yeah, Matt Damon's fat. He's got the mustache, right? Like they did the 40-year-old virgin poster.
Yeah, and then we talked to you a month later. It's like, Jesse Plemons wasn't that, right?
Yeah. Jesse Plemons. Yeah. Looks just like Jesse Plemons. But, yeah, it's just, it exists. Like, it's ultimately forgettable. I agree.
Well, let's give Tori, the super fan, the final word on your final thoughts on The Informant. I'm sorry, The Informant!
Man, we are. I'm beginning to get the whole running the jokes into the ground thing from you, Tom. I think that's coming full circle now. Like, you know, The Informant. Oh God, no. Okay, sorry. All right. So as far as final thoughts were concerned, I mean, like, when I was like 18, when this film came out, I was like in high school when this came out. And I remember seeing the trailers, the posters, like how this whole thing was looking. It just didn't really have anything interesting that I need, that I really wanted to see. So, you know, seeing it for the episode today, I was like, you know, this is really good. This is above average. I'm not going to say it's the best Soderbergh film, whatsoever. Like, I wouldn't even put it in like a top five for Soderbergh movies, but I gotta say, like, it was really solid. I really wasn't bored. And I think it's just one of those films where like the performances and just the banter between the characters was kind of enough to just kind of keep me engrossed. You know what I mean? And yeah, I mean, it's not something like I'm definitely not going to be going like, listen, The Informant is a classic. Like, no, like I'm not trying to get that vibe off at all, but I really didn't see a bad film here, which is, you know, so I mean, that would be my final thoughts. I think it's like, you know, it's above average. It's a really solid film. I would say, you know, give it a chance, see it. But good chance, you know, you're going to have either a me reaction or, you know, Adam and Tom, you know, it seems like it just has that sort of reception or sort of a reputation.
Well, that is the end of our discussion of our two films. We'll be picking our next two films for next week at the very end of the episode. So stay tuned for that. And, first we have some feedback to read, because every Monday at DEDB Pod on Facebook and Twitter, we ask y'all, hey, what are your favorite movies related to whatever topic we're doing? So we asked y'all about Mr. Soderbergh's filmography, and we had some takers here, including James Rodriguez, just last week's guest, says, Magic Mike is a compelling character study wrapped in an energetic and fun package. Aaron Brockovich sees a real-life story brought to the screen in such an understated yet gripping way. Behind the Candelabra is an exceptional biopic brought to life from the lavish costumes to Rob Lowe's makeup, and Ocean's 11 is an energetically crafted heist flick with a great load of fun to it. Ocean's 12 is still fun to me, but the whole Julia Roberts side plot is a step too far for me. And then Jonathan Habdemichael says, Steven Soderbergh is the rare auteur that criticized the uniformity of modern Hollywood filmmaking and continues to make great film and television. I could bring up an Ocean's movie or Aaron Brockovich, but he has the best 2010s of any director, with Contagion is a pandemic film that we deserve, Unsane Side Effects are great thrillers dealing with mental health, and any film with Channing Tatum is a guaranteed good time, except maybe Haywire, because of Gina Carano. Christian Alvarez says, Steven Soderbergh is a fantastic modern-age director that's willing to prove his immense amount of talent by directing across various genres, directing amazing high-profile casts, and he's capable of making his movies so intense despite few missteps in his career over the years. His best films would include Traffic, Ocean's 11, Contagion, and Behind the Candelabra. His missteps include Ocean's 12, which is an overcomplicated attempt at recreating the magic of the original, The Informant, which has an interesting cast but is underwhelming, and Solaris hasn't been able to keep my interest every time I try to watch it. Bruce at the_era_Bruce says, worst, The Laundromat, best, Sex, Lies, and Videotape. And then Ryan Quarterman says the Ocean's trilogy is one of the only perfect trilogies. Magic Mike is perfect. Side Effects fucks. Unsane is a banger. High Flying Bird doesn't get nearly enough love. Logan Lucky is a blast. Haywire is an amazing spy film, and The Laundromat is good, it's just people aren't smart enough to get it. Soderbergh is constantly pushing the boundaries and creating new and exciting stories, to the point I for sure know I'm missing some here that I love, but he just has so many good things. Steven is bae.
Ryan, never change, buddy.
Yeah, fucking guy. you know, I tend to agree with most of those. I actually am a pretty big fan of Solaris. I know it's definitely one of those movies that is incredibly divisive, if not almost universally just kind of disliked. I think it looks the shit. I love the score. The score is one of my favorite film scores of the last 25 years, without a doubt. Logan Lucky's good. I like it. It feels like Soderbergh's version of a Coen Brothers movie, but I think it's pretty good.
Daniel Craig and nothing else in that movie is so fucking phenomenal.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. I really do enjoy Ocean's 11 quite a bit. That falls in line almost with what I was talking about earlier, like this era of just these cool sort of crime movies that were coming out. Ocean's 11 was definitely sort of the most polished version of that. But I really enjoy that one still. I like Magic Mike as well. I think Magic Mike is a surprise of a movie. Like Magic Mike is definitely one of those ones you go in expecting something, and it turns out to be something completely different in a really good way. But yeah, like I said, I'm not as versed on Soda Bread as I'd like to be. It is what it is. I don't know that I ever will. I don't know that I have the sort of drive to seek out his other stuff as sort of an auteur and try to discover something. But from what I've seen, I do enjoy his stuff. And yes, I did call him Soda Bread. That's his name. Soda Bread's his name.
Soderbergh. Well, Soderbergh, for me, when it comes to Soderbergh, it's like a lot of films that I saw that I've seen out of his, I actually didn't realize he made. Like, for instance, mid-2000s film called The Good German, which doesn't have like the greatest positive reception, but I really enjoyed. And as far as like the 2010s go, I'm two-thirds with Jonathan because I've never seen Contagion, but I really love Unsane and Side Effects. Side Effects was one of my favorite films of 2013. But there's also a lot of Soderbergh I haven't seen. Like, I still haven't seen Logan Lucky. I really never really saw Traffic, to be honest. I'd say Traffic and Aaron Brockovich I haven't really seen. For me, Soderbergh, it's like The Ocean's Trilogy, Unsane, Side Effects, The Good German. Of course, you know, the two films that we've seen today. And that's been pretty much my exposure to him. So I have a lot really to dig in when it comes to his work, especially Magic Mike. My girlfriend's really trying to get me to see Magic Mike. And I think I guess I should give that a chance. So
it has like the fun sort of like male stripper stuff. But then it also culminates it with like, hey, you know, all this fun male stripper stuff. These people are very broken and sad. And they live really shitty lives and they backstab each other all the time.
So it's Boogie Nights.
Kind of, yeah. It's like the Boogie Nights with male strippers, yeah.
Oh, okay. All right.
But, I mean, I would say I agree that I hadn't really seen a lot of his movies, but until, like, fairly recently, either doing research for this or over, like, the past year or so, just out of boredom, I watched some of his stuff. Really, with Traffic, technically, you may not have seen that particular movie, but you've kind of seen Traffic if you've seen any, like, drug cartel movie that's come out over the past 20 years. Because, like, Traffic pretty much created the modern sort of like, oh, hey, we're in Mexico, there's a yellow filter over everything, and there's like all this like, you know, drug related kind of like drama that's going on. That's the thing, is if nothing else, like, I'm not a huge fan of Traffic necessarily, but I can see like every like big Oscar movie about drugs has ripped this movie off wholesale. The guy innovates, and even with stuff like, he creates stars, like I would say one we haven't somehow mentioned in all this, but Out of Sight is such a phenomenal movie that really made Clooney like a movie star. Because the thing is, like, he was still licking his wounds from Batman and Robin right after that. Like, at this time, it's like, oh shit, what's he gonna do now? Like, is he gonna just be the ER guy? The guy who's on Facts of Life? Return of the Killer Tomatoes? Like, that, is he gonna just be that kind of guy? And then that really, like, helped blossom his career, and Soderbergh's really, like, kind of shepherded him, and, like, Matt Damon, a lot of those people in the Ocean's cast, wouldn't be as big a star as if not for him, I would argue.
I would say Out of Sight's probably the one solid J-Lo performance you'll see in a film. So, I mean, hey.
Someone hasn't seen Hustlers.
Nope.
Really?
Good. Phenomenal. Oh, yeah. Great.
Okay.
Hustlers, dope. Huh?
All right. Well, I mean, Magic Mike and Hustlers, that's definitely going to be an interesting Saturday night viewing. That's for sure.
or even like with Benicio Del Toro. I think he did, like, Benicio Del Toro obviously was working and done like Usual Suspects and stuff. But I would argue he blew up with like weirdly Traffic. Like, that's such a weird Oscar win for that dude. Like, he won an Oscar and he's just been doing the weirdest character choices ever since. And he's even done stuff like, I managed to watch the two-part Shay movie, the Shay Guevara movie that Soderbergh did with him. Which
that's
is like
very, ooh, actually I forgot that one. That's another one I saw, both parts even. I kind of like part two better. It's a lot. You,
what are you talking about? 4.5 hours? what are you talking about? That's nothing.
Dedicated afternoon to that shit, man. But it's an experience. I don't know if it's like a great films, but it's an experience.
I actually would say I prefer the first one because that one is more about like Shay's rise and also kind of juxtaposing that with his UN visit in the 60s. I think it's a lot more intriguing, kind of like a juxtaposition, as opposed to, I think the fall kind of feels like, oh, we're doing another guerrilla warfare thing, but it kind of like ultimately fails, obviously, because of what happened historically. But it's still like a noble experiment that nobody really gave a shit about. And I love the fact that that's the thing, is like he's even able to like evolve from that and eventually get to like the iPhone phase. Or I would definitely agree, Ryan mentioned High Flying Bird, which is on Netflix, is phenomenal and isn't getting enough love. And it's about Andre Holland plays a guy who's like an agent for basketball players in the middle of like a lockdown for basketball. And he sort of is this guy who's doing a bit of like behind the scenes machinations to basically subvert the basketball system. I don't want to really say what kind of happens with the ending because the ending is a great like pow punch of a surprise. But it's like this really interesting kind of like character dramedy that gets you invested in like, oh, it's just behind the scenes dealings of basketball. And then it like punches you in the gut with the ending in a way that I think really works. Personally, I would say that is the behind the scenes sports drama movie I prefer vastly over like a Moneyball. Like, everybody loved Moneyball, which was supposed to be Soderbergh, actually. It was going to be Soderbergh with Pitt, and actually instead of Jonah Hill, Dimitri Martin was going to play that part.
Interesting.
Which, yeah, would have been a really different movie, probably. But I vastly prefer a High Flying Bird, though. And then, once again, the iPhone cinematography, you just feel really immersed and you don't feel like it looks cheap. And it's the same way with Unsane. I love the way that movie looks and gets you, like, really intimately close to everything that's going on.
Yeah.
I haven't gotten my chance to see Unsane yet. I've been wanting to see it just out of pure fascination. But I definitely do want to watch the High Flying Bird one. I really like Andre Holland. I'm kind of a sucker for a good sports drama, but you know, there's kind of few far in between that aren't sort of the cookie cutter sort of stereotype. You've seen it 1,000 times already. So that one, I might watch that either post show or tomorrow.
Yeah, especially if it's similar to Moneyball, because I mean, like, Moneyball is such a great movie that it kind of signifies as to why baseball is just complete shit now. So if it's like, if this is like even an improvement on that, and like, especially looking at this cast, I mean, Andre Holland was fantastic in Moonlight. I'd like to actually see something in something where he's like the main, you know, star vehicle of this. So I think I'm going to be in Adam's camp. I think I'm going to see this after we're done tonight.
Yeah, and Zazie Beetz is also there. Zachary Quinto, Bill Duke, our man, also appears in it as well. Very good underrated movie. And like I said, I think my least favorite is The Laundromat. I think The Laundromat is just like a colossal failure of a movie because like it made me respect more of like The Big Short. Because The Big Short works in that you're playing like the shell game. Like you're on yeah. like the side of the street and like the guy's doing the shell game with you and completely hustling you while he's distracting you. And that works for like that movie. But The Laundromat feels a lot more like when you're watching Vice and they're doing that. Where it's like, I get what you're going for, dude. But I kind of just don't care what you're talking about. Like, you're just kind of repeating the same points over and over. And it's a lot of, like, Gary Oldman and Antonio Banderas, like, talking to the audience. And Gary Oldman's doing this really bad Werner Herzog impression the whole time. And it's just like, what the fuck's even happening? Like, and it's this weird anthology thing where you think the main character is Meryl Streep. And then they tell you, like, 5 different stories about the Panama Papers. And they just keep cutting back to, like, oh, hey, Streep's still in this movie. But let's go back to this other story about the Panama Papers. It's like a really bad anthology comedy, almost, with the way it's constructed. It's just, it's weird.
Yeah, it seemed annoying from the trailer alone, and I kind of was just like, eh, I'll get to it when I see it. I just saw The Big Short, and I'm, you know, I can't have another angry, triggered panic attack like it. Just, and this one doesn't even look like it has that emotional weight anyway, so you know, maybe it's going to be something I see down the line where I'm bored.
But thank you all for contributing that feedback. We also want to thank some other people like Chris Oliver for the intro and outro music used in our show. Listen to more of his music at chrisoliver.bandcamp.com. Thanks to Emily Scarter for the art for our show. And thanks to our loyal patrons over at patreon.com/DEDBpod, where for just $1 a month, you get to vote in polls where you choose either topics or specific movies we do for the show. And you even get bonus podcasts. Like later this month, we'll be doing our commentary for Tron Legacy, which I know Adam's a big fan of, and I'm not as big on. So that'll be interesting to hear us go back and forth about it. So thank you to all you Edgelord level patrons, including Torrey here, who's a patron.
Hey, also Adam is right with Tron Legacy, and Tom, you are wrong. So wrong.
Well, I have yet to revisit it before we record the commentary, so I might change my tone. Who knows? By the time we record, you'll have to listen.
You're not.
Shut up. I'm trying to get them to do the fucking Patreon. You'll have to listen to find out. Oh. But obviously, Torrey, we're thanking you for being a patron, but just thank you for appearing on the episode, and why don't you plug yourself a bit?
I don't really have much to plug.
Don't say that. Don't say that about yourself.
My low self-esteem. No, but if you want to follow me on Twitter, I mean, feel free to at TCVB491. You can type Doomposter in right now, RIP FMF Doom. That's who it's dedicated to. But yeah, that would be a thing, you know, plug. I got a Twitter to plug, nothing much else to plug. And I want to thank everyone for having me on this episode, even though I feel like I kind of just rambled my thoughts on through for the last hour.
Unlike me and Adam, who never do that. We never do that on the show. That's not the whole point of the show, is us rambling on about bullshit.
I am so concise in my train of thought. Everything is written down and scripted. I never stammer or go off on tangents about how Nicolas Cage is banging Jessica Biel. Never happens.
I barely edit the show at all. It's just perfect. It just comes out whole. Basically, by the time...
I'm so good. I'm fucking top-notch podcasting.
You know, if you want more top-notch podcasting, you can follow us on, you know, our different social medias like Twitter and Facebook at DEDBpod, where we ask you those feelers that we mentioned earlier for, like, what your favorite, least favorite things related to a topic. And also, you can email us feedback at doubleedgedshellville@gmail.com, all spelled out. And you know what? You also can not only hear what we do, but you can wear and drink out of, you know, our logo. If you go over to the Tee Public store for the ESO Network, you can buy mugs or face masks or t-shirts with our lovely logo on it, and just wear your pride around for Double Edged Devil Bill.
Yeah, and we might actually get a few schmeckles back for that. So if you can, go at shekels, schmeckles, what the fuck is wrong? Again, perfect. I am so good at this.
Now this is being edited out at all.
Yeah, no. It shouldn't be. No, but yeah, we might get a little kickback on that. But yeah, go ahead, buy a mask. Stay safe, buy a mask. Get a coffee mug. Drink hand sanitizer out of it. Whatever you gotta do. Stay safe.
We don't endorse drinking hand sanitizer. But we do endorse you following us on our social medias, and even myself on my social media platforms, which include Twitter, Instagram, and Letterboxd as @NotTheWho'sTommy. And I also do some writing at MarianiThomas.wordpress.com.
Yes, and I am also on Instagram and Twitter at Atom or Adam, @AtomOr_ADAM. Yeah, go ahead and follow me on there. I don't do much on there. I'll share pictures of things I might have painted late night, tired, bored, and that's about it.
They're really great paintings. I mean, honestly, maybe if you see them, you know, you fans could offer a dollary do or two to Adam here for his hard work. You know?
Sell them to you. Yeah, whatever you want.
You know, anything, you know?
No, well, that's what the money will go for. Don't send me here.
There needs to be a middle ground here.
Yeah, come on.
Well, and you know, but you can follow Adam, you know, because, like, unlike some other people, Adam and I and Torrey are on Twitter.
Yeah, we're not permanently banned.
No, we're not permanently banned, like certain high-profile politicians.
Yep.
Topical. You know when this episode was recorded.
Hey.
For more of our unfiltered brilliance, you can subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, and other podcasting platforms out there. And if you're listening on the ESO Network, why not dig into the other great shows or go into our Podbean feed for the archive for several episodes we did even before we joined the ESO Network. If nothing else, if you can't buy our merch or become a patron, we would appreciate you just for free rating, reviewing, or sharing the show around to give us more visibility and more potential listeners.
Yeah, man. And you know what? Even if you don't want to leave a fucking electronic paper trail, use word of mouth. Good old-fashioned word of mouth. Tell your friends.
Have you heard about that double-edged double bill? It's the real bee's knees.
Yeah, also share it, though. Share it so we can see that you're doing it.
Yes, we would appreciate that. Yes.
Yeah, we want to see it. Or else, but fuck you, you're a liar.
But now, Adam, it's time to do our picking for next week's episode. And it's an interesting topic that you actually suggested. You know, the informant... Sorry, The Informant had a lot of stand-up comedians in the cast, and we decided to kind of continue that line going with we're doing stand-up comedian movie vehicles. So movies designed to promote certain stand-up types that are coming up in the world, which is an interesting topic. I wouldn't have figured.
Yeah, it's always kind of fascinated me, or even not necessarily that we're designed for them to come up in the world, but you might see a stand-up that just pops up in this weird movie and you're really surprised at how, you know, potentially either A, how good they can be as an actor, or B, how awful it can go too.
Right. Hence perfect for our show. Cause you have two good movies we could potentially get one of as a good pick. I have the same for my two bad choices, and we've each assigned numbers between 1 and 10 for them. And usually we would pick a number between 1 and 10 for each other's choices. And that's what gets us close to a good and a bad. But Torrey, given her being he's our guest, gets to go ahead and do the picking with the numbers. So for Adam's two good choices, Torrey, number between 1.
Well, guys, I appreciate you for informing me of the rules. God, please kill me. Anyways, you said 1 to 10, 4.
All right. At number 2, I have a movie I have not seen. I've seen the trailer for. I've read some of the reviews. It sounds incredibly interesting. Stars a pretty underrated comedian named Nick Thune. I don't know if you guys know who that is. It's called Dave Made a Maze.
Wow, I've heard of this movie. I've never seen it either. Okay.
Neither. Cool. Interesting trailer. Sounds cool. Okay. And at number 10, I have a movie starring a comedian. I do not like her. But I enjoyed the movie. I had Trainwreck with Amy Schumer.
Yeah, I really like Trainwreck, and that was the movie where it was like, oh man, Amy Schumer's going places. And she didn't quite go places.
Yeah, she
did. Hey guys, I saved the podcast from having to talk about that movie. Yeah.
It's not a bad movie. Fuck
it's,
off.
It's not. It's not. I'm kidding.
Speaking of bad movies, Torrey, time for you to pick number between 1 and 10 for my two bad choices.
All right. I'm double my last guess. I get it. 8. It's 8.
Okay. I'm so sorry, Adam. So, at number 9, I had a movie starring maybe not the most beloved stand-up, and especially before he kind of got ripped weirdly in the last few decades of his career. I have the Carrot Top Vehicle Chairman of the Board.
Jesus
Christ. Oh man, I am amazing.
Oh boy.
Dude, I'm just gonna if I'm on this again, I'm just gonna double and just double my original number guess and just keep getting these amazing smack together combos here.
Well, if you had depleted your choice, you would have gotten closer to number 1, where I had Jumpin' Jack Flash, the Whoopi Goldberg vehicle.
We're good.
Oh, jeez, man. What the fuck?
Look, we're picking bad movies here. I ain't playing around with these bad movies.
Those are bad fucking movies. God.
Well, on that note, everybody, we hope you had an exciting time this episode, and we'll end it on an exciting note of The Informant!
The Informant!
No.
Thank you.
This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network. Be part of the crew and help support our shows by donating to our ESO Patreon or by shopping for the Tee Public store, which can all be found at www.esonetwork.com. The ESO Network, your station for all things geek.